John, good evening. How you doing,
Good
man?
evening. Good. I'm hot.
It's
Not
hot.
hot looking. It's hot. It's 180 degrees today in
You could say
Vegas.
you're hot. I mean, it's good,
No.
man. You got a beautiful hat. You got a
I
great
do.
shirt.
Shirt,
I have.
hat.
You got version one. I got
Right.
version two. Everyone, if you could see
Yeah.
that, look
No,
at that.
it's just it's a little warm outside here in Las Vegas. Like I said, I think it's 182 degrees today in Vegas.
Yeah, dude, that's hot.
But like I always tell my friends in the Midwest, I don't have to shovel heat, so I'm
There
okay with
you
it.
go. There you go. Well, hey, listen, I am super stoked to talk about tonight's episode because it's one that I like. And let me pull in a quote from Goodfellas by Martin Scorsese, which is just one of the greatest movies of all time. But he was talking about a character on there, Jimmy Conway, for those who know, that was played by Robert De Niro, and a Ray Liotta, whose character, Henry, whatever, is talking about this character, Jimmy Conway. And he's saying, Jimmy in the movies rooted for the bad guy. And that somehow stuck with me. And we were talking about episodes and topics and whatnot. And I said, you know what? Why don't we talk about the villain? And because to me, in many cases, the dark side, or as you know, John, I love to talk about the dark side, but I often find it much more interesting. And the characters are much more layered and complex than the kind of linear good guy who's can be very predictable, right? And we talked a little bit about that with Karate Kid, with Danny LaRusso versus Johnny Lawrence. Everyone inside really likes Johnny. And I don't know if you had the same type of thoughts, you know, opposed to the man in black versus the man in white.
I think you're right. I always root for the good guy. I'm a typical red-blooded American. I root for the good guy, but when you go back and look at those movies, many of these movies will talk about these villains. They are amazing characters. And that's why most actors, when you talk to them, would rather play a villain than a hero, just because they're more complex, they're more difficult, there's more layers to them. And it takes a great deal more talent sometimes to be the bad guy because people really don't like you. And I agree with you. The bad guy is usually the one that's the most interesting versus the hero, which is lovely, but oftentimes, like you said, more lineal, and a little bit less, more thinly veiled than, let's say, the villain.
Yeah, it's funny. I think, what did Paul McCartney say in Ebony and Ivory? There's good and bad in everyone. Very, very either genius or very trite statement. And I thought recent comments from Dave Chappelle about Will Smith's infamous slap. He said that Will Smith had been playing this perfect good guy for the past 30 years, and finally, with one violent smack, he became real in a way, or showed a side that we all have. And I think Dave Chappelle was very smart in saying that just to be good is not a real portrayal of the human experience. We do have sides in us, and I think when you can separate those and isolate those in a bad character, because you know there's times when you do root for the bad guy because you're like, yeah, man, I'd want to hit that dude. Or there's this devilish side in you. And I could see why, especially like the anti-hero, like someone like Johnny Lawrence, who plays the real villain, or even our idol, Steph McKay, on Pretty in Pink. You see it can go that way where they're super bad, but then they'll have a side of them that shows that just as a good guy can have a bad side, a bad guy can have a good side. And I think it's that play that reminds us kind of our human nature in a way. But isolating and having the dude be all bad is just a lot of fun.
It is.
And so when you're looking at villains, what have you seen, John? Some of like kind of the main characteristics or items that make a good villain versus one that's not good.
I mean, typically, they're about a villain. There's always an arrogance, a sense of ego and cockiness about them, right? They're definitely someone who is going against what's right, at least in people's minds. Mm-hmm. In the movie, it's someone who you immediately can identify, okay, this guy's the bad guy, because this is like, he, what he's doing is inherently bad, right? So they tend to have a lot of the same characteristics. They're usually a lot more cerebral, you know. Mm-hmm. They're usually a lot deeper sometimes, not all the time. Sometimes they're just batshit crazy, which is also really fun. When they're kind of just off the wall, I just find the villain sometimes more creative, you know, in the character and in how they're different, all the different layers within them. But there's always a sense of like ego and cockiness, and then just sort of you know, when you can immediately, like I said, find the villain by this sort of darkness that surrounds them in some way, shape, or form. And sometimes they're like Steph, like he's just a good looking dude in a suit with the hair and the smoke and the sunglasses. But you can tell like his ego and his cockiness, like the guy's an asshole. But I mean, he's kind of cool. Like, look at Darth Vader. I mean, he was badass looking Darth Vader, but he is a total jerk. But the guy was freaking cool. I mean, at the same time.
Definitely. There's something where in our human psyche that we kind of know we have this bad side in us. And so when someone's able to kind of fully go with it and all the things you want to do, I mean, everyone thinks it, right? You know, you're at a party or at a bar and there's some jerk off, some douchebag doing something. You would love just to pop them in the face. But in today's world, you'd be on answer. Your career is over. So when you can have a character live out that maybe dark side of you, it's quite liberating. And I think it's one of those that it's, we're all kind of playing within these, you know, we have to be good citizens and there's rules and there's dire consequences if you break these rules. So when you see a villain that just has no apologies and, and doing all the things that you kind of want to do in a certain way, I mean, even characters like Gordon Gekko on Wall Street, right? I mean, he's just like, greed is good, which for many people, you know, seeing that movie, there's a side going, yeah, man, I want to make that money. I want to have that hot girl and I want to treat people like shit.
I think you're right, Scott. And you bring up a really good point. Like when you talk about Gordon Gekko and a lot of these villains, what I also find about these guys too, guys, girls, whoever they are, is there is a compelling backstory to these people too. Like I find that each of these villains comes with like a story behind them. Yeah. Like I think of Darth Vader automatically. The backstory about how Darth Vader got to be that guy in black with the mask is a very deep and dark past, right? And a lot of these villains have that really mainly disturbing. Or at some point, they may start out good and then flip to the bad side because they've got something in their life that triggered them to be bad. Maybe they started out good, but maybe they were just born a bad person. But there's always some kind of story, whether you're talking about, you know, Star Wars or Lord of the Rings or whatever kind of movie it might be. There is a backstory to every villain. I find that very common.
Well, I think your example with Lord of the Rings, you know, on some of these lists that talk about movie villains, one that is predominantly on there is Gollum, who I don't really classify him as a villain. He's more of a victim. And his backstory, you know, it essentially, you know, he was an innocent, like almost bystander that almost, you know, kind of got possessed by this ring. And it's more of a victim than anything. But I agree with you. That's where this, I mean, even today's society, you know, you have people that are really bad and then it's never like, I just had a normal life. Great parents, loving you. When you read, you know, what a lot of it is this, I don't know, generational sin, but this, I don't know, karmic effect, but they were abused or there was something very, very bad that happened to them. And now there's a reason for why they're doing this kind of horrible thing.
Yeah.
And I think it's that complexity, right? And so like movies like Psycho and you're just kind of like, this guy did not have a normal life.
Right. Right. Something triggered Norman Bates to be the way he was. No, you're right. I mean, and I think that's what makes villains at the end of the day fun. I mean, villains are always kind of the fun guys to watch. They're always that, you know, they're always what I would say. They're a worthy opponent always to the hero, right? There's always that, like that. There's always that struggle between like Danny LaRusso and, you know, Johnny, like there's always like that sort of worthy opponents, whether it's Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader or whoever it might be. There's always, you see that oftentimes is very common as well.
Well, I think, for example, with the Batman series with the Joker, I find in many cases people are so much more fascinated
with
the bad, right? With the bad side. Yeah. And the Joker, you can probably tell Hollywood is really focusing him because I think it's talking about, you know, the recent one with River Phoenix, I believe. What's not River Phoenix? What's his brother or cousin?
Joaquin Phoenix.
Sorry, man. But that really went into this very sad backstory, almost tragic. And so you're seeing the results of this bad behavior. And I think you've been seeing today's society with, and not getting political here on Steph Nation, but this idea of these crazy people going ballistic and doing this, and you read their stories and you're like, gosh, it's just tragic. But then you have those villains that, as you said, they're kind of the sexy villain, either the 80s asshole, which we talked about, the bad boy, or the slick banker, or these guys that come from these positions of power, where they're almost aspirational. Like you're like, I want to be that guy, man. I want to, you know, have like that power and just treat everyone like shit and everyone loves you.
Yeah. You know? It is true. And there's always something unique about all those villains too. I think all of them have they have a unique quality about them, whether it's like their intelligence or like they're just good looking, or they have a great sense of style, or they're a good dancer, whatever it might be. Right. Like there's always something interesting about these characters. Sometimes it's multiple things. Maybe they're very dynamic and layered in terms of the kind of person they are. Yeah. But it's true. It's what makes them fun. I mean, the villains are fun. Like, even though we hate them, and there's a few on this list that I have that I literally freaking hate, but they're so good. They're so good.
Yeah. And that intelligence is key because that's where you see, that formidable opponent, right? Usually the good guy and he's doing everything right. And he's the smart, he's, you know, good looking and he's got all the physical attributes or even, you know, obviously female, same thing. And then, but when the villain is very crafty and it usually is that way. And you could say that about good and evil, you know, metaphysically that the evil is very deceptive. It knows how to press these buttons. And I think that's a larger symbol. But I think those are the ones you really pay attention to. And I even think, and we'll get some of these lists and some that you mentioned specifically, John, I'm not going to steal your thunder here, but ones that are amorphous or that are not a physical human. It could be an animal, like I'll just say it in Jaws.
Yep.
You had mentioned Jack Torrance.
Yeah.
Of The Shining. Yeah. Now I want to, so we talked about the major aspects of this villain, which is the villains tend to be fun, but a lot of it's because they're intelligent. They're not too, if they're too goofy, then you don't, they're not really a villain. They're just more like a side character.
Right.
But this idea of the backstory, there's always a rationale for this evil behavior, so to speak. And I think you get that layered, that complexity that keeps the audience interested and you want to know more because he's just not this kind of linear or like superficial character, or at least the good ones, right? The good villains.
Yeah.
But going down on some of your list, we've given some examples here, but tell me about Jack Torrance.
That's one of my favorite movies of all time. I wouldn't say of all time. It's one of my favorite movies. I love The Shining. I love The Shining. I saw it in the theater. When it was in the theater, like I was like five, my dad took me to see it. Like it wouldn't disturb me at all. And I went to see it, and my dad loved it because he would talk about, Jack Nicholson playing Jack Torrance, and he did it so well. Yeah. I mean, he was so good at that movie, and he started out like a family guy. He was like, the family guy, had his wife and kid. They're going to go and basically sit at this hotel. But you see, obviously, in the movie, they talk about, they say, this is kind of a cursed hotel. And you see him slowly lose his mind. Now, mind you, his wife, Was it not Shelley Winters?
Shelley Duvall.
Shelley Duvall. I would kill her too. Okay, so just saying, Jack wasn't all incorrect in that point, and his kid was super annoying. But he, you watch him turn into this very dark, disturbed individual, yeah. Like before your eyes. It's almost like he was kind of an innocent victim. He went there with the best of intentions, and then the hotel, alone, isolated in the mountains, in the snow, in the dead of winter. His mind began to play with him. Psychologically, yeah. He began to screw himself up, and he became this killer, this crazed, hilarious, but super intelligent kind of character. And he was imagining all these, he was hallucinating the bartender. And at the end, like, he's just chasing his wife with an axe. I mean,
yeah. You know?
Well, and you were so scared. Like, mind you wanted to kind of kill Shelley Duvall, but then you felt bad. And, but he just became like this monster at the end. That was the scariest shit. Well, it was a great, great villain.
Yeah. I definitely agree that he was the kind of on the forefront, this tragic character that went, you know, basically snow crazy, whatever you call it, snowbound. Yeah. But I thought the house, right? Or no, sorry, the hotel, like that as a haunting villain.
Could have been a villain.
Right? Because it wasn't just him. It was this haunted hotel that was this evil presence. And I think, you know, Stanley Kubrick perfectly portrayed that with this eerie, there wasn't a lot of background music. There were just long shots of the hallway. I mean, it's a regular looking hotel in a way, but then the way he shot it, just even the carpet, it was, and that's what I thought. It's not your traditional villain. Obviously we saw with the animals, you know, you have like Cujo, which is the dog.
Yeah.
Got
right,
every type
right.
of piranha, and you got obviously Jaws.
Right.
But I thought The Shining, with the house, was
it's true.
It was
the
just
house
evil.
Could have really been. Yeah, it was. That's a good point. The house, if you think about the hotel, could have been the real villain because it turned this guy into a nut job. Now his wife and kid were okay, but it attached on to him. It saw him as vulnerable. Saw him as the vulnerable one because he was starting to get bored, and the hotel almost sensed it and then changed him into this killer. So in a sense, the inanimate object, the house itself, or the hotel itself and the spirit within it could have been the villain in this case, for sure. Yeah, but great movie.
And I think one of the, in terms of its effect, I found that when you can't see it, or you, it really plays to your imagination of what is it.
Absolutely.
That imagination of evil, just like anything, you're scared of something because you can't really see it. And then your mind just will go nuts and try to formulate some type of symbol so you can process it. But so when you can't, I think that's when people freak out. And that's why I think that movie was so scary, and this evil villain, if you will, you couldn't see. And I think that's what made Jaws so captivating, because all you heard was the cello, right? The dun, 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 and then you didn't really see anything. And then finally you see it, and it's almost scarier when you don't see it.
Jaws is my favorite villain of all time. I can't even call him a villain, really. I mean, he's in the ocean. Oh, yeah. We're in the ocean. We're in his territory. So, I mean, if you get eaten, tough shit, but I kind of liked him as the villain. He was a fun one.
Yeah. I thought another one that was non-traditional, but so creepy was in No Country for Old Men, the character, Anton, for those of you
that's a good one.
And he's almost not human. You know, he's got this horrific haircut, and he is, just so creepy and so, I think,
just dead face.
Yeah.
Right?
And I think that was it. It was this inanimate. And so when he's talking, or he's, you know, acting like a human, it really messes with your circuitry. Yeah. And I think that makes this, like, this guy is a monster, but he's human. Yeah. And I think that was a very well done movie that just made you feel like this guy is freaking messed up. He's a true villain.
He was like a better version of the Terminator, right? Yeah. He wasn't a robot. He was like this almost, it's this person laser focused on what he's got to do and who he's got to kill. And he just literally would just walk through a wall. He'd go through anything And he just showed like no emotion. Like emotion was taken, like that switch was turned off. Yeah. And he just, it was creepy and a great, great character. Such a good character.
I think those ones are the ones that really affected me in a way, because you can't figure it out. I think when you see a villain and they're very kind of traditional, right, dressed in black, a lot of your kind of James Bond villains will be that traditional. And I think they're fun and they're almost parodied because they're so, they have all the obvious cues of being a villain. You know, they're shaved head with a jumpsuit on, you know, stroking a cat. But I think in the movies, like you said in The Shining, where you take someone and you see that deterioration, you see this Jack Torrance going from a family guy to killing the family. But the house, I thought, or the, sorry, man, the hotel was just absolutely disturbing.
Yeah.
And I think it's that villain you can't see, that, that Elliot, but what else do you got on your list that you want to share with
them? There's one that I have a lot. I'll say there's one that I just, in terms of like a character that I just hated. And there's been a couple different versions of this film called Cape Fear. Right. There was one early one that was done where the main character, Max Cady, was played by Robert Mitchum, who is an amazing actor in his time. Yeah. But there was a remake in the 80s, maybe early 90s, where Robert De Niro played Max Cady, and he did it, and Nick Nolte played the lawyer, and he did it so well. And he is such, I mean, like, he's a guy, like, when you watch that movie, you just want to jump out of your seat and kill him. Like, you just want to jump through the screen, grab Max Cady, and beat the shit out of him. Like, you literally, because he's so, De Niro plays that role I would say he played it even better than Bob Mitchum, because I hated him so much when I saw that movie, because it was a remake and I was kind of like, how are you going to remake this? But the characters were so good, and he did such a great job as Max Cady. I just wanted to, like, he was just an evil guy, like evil from birth, came from a bad upbringing, was in jail forever. He goes after the lawyer that put him there, and he has just evil, and he's so smart. And just the devious ways that he pokes at his target, at his prey, just pokes at him through his family, through himself. I just wanted to kill him. And that's so when you know the character is so good.
Yeah, exactly. When it elicits that visceral, like, hate or whatever.
Oh my goodness. I hated him.
Now, which villain would you want to be?
That's a tough call.
Besides Steph, of course.
Yeah, you know, in terms of like overall villain, you know, not going into the James Bond villains, because that's another episode. it's hard to say because there's so many, but just from like a physical presence and cool factor, Darth Vader. I mean, the dude just is all in black. He's got a cape. He's got a lightsaber. Yeah. I mean, people, he can kill somebody with his, you know, going like this. I mean, he has the Jedi stuff. You know, it's hard to say I wouldn't want to be Darth Vader because he could kick anybody's ass at the end of the day. So I think if I had to be a villain, that'd be a pretty dope one to be, you know? Yeah. So if you had to be a villain, who would be your person? Who would you pick?
Great question. I liked Gordon Gekko. I thought he represented like almost like a true American villain, where he was just like super honest, very clever, manipulative, and just fun, because I think, you know, being in the business world, you always want to say that stuff. You just want to be that way and just go, hey, man, I'm doing this just to fuck you over. I just want to make as much money as I can. Because that's what all these guys are thinking, especially in business, right? Yeah. You know, but they're not sincere about it, and you just want.
Well, they can't. He had no filter. He's like, just hey, take it or leave it. This is what it is.
Yeah, and we talked
about make money. We can't. It's hard to do that in business today. You have to kind of, you know, filter yourself.
Well, when he talked about love, you know, when Daryl Hannah's asking him about a relationship, he's like, "Come on, love is just there so people won't jump out of windows." And, you know, it's just really freaking intelligent. Yeah. And I think that's why he's a villain that people aspire to. It's like, oh man, I'm, you know,
yeah,
like Gordon Gekko, greed is good. You know, in my fraternity, which had a lot of aspiring bankers and financial, you know, investment bankers and whatnot, they love that movie.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
they would turn it off right when Charlie Sheen went bad, you know?
Yeah. That's awesome. But, that's a good one.
That's one. But one other villain that I thought was non-traditional way too was Nurse Ratched on One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
She's good.
For those, you know, this is in 1975 with Jack Nicholson, you know, but he's playing actually the protagonist. And just the way she was not obvious, she's poking and just really crushing all the people in there. So that was,
she was
that
very was a, good.
Another one. But I think overall, you know, it's just these villains, just like in anything, you want the dark side and the light, right? The dark and light. So I think it's just such a critical component of just any type of either in literature or movies, the conflict, you know, you have Jesus and you have the devil, right? You have God and the devil. Even in metaphysics, they have to have something evil, right? It's like, well, what would it be if you just, you know, had an absolutely no evil? And I think it's not to get too philosophical here, but it's kind of just part of the universe. You have light energy and dark energy. But I think it's so much more fun to go into the dark.
Well, and you have these different versions of dark, right? Like, for example, mm-hmm. one of my favorite, you know, bad guys is Mr. Potter from A Wonderful Life, right? Yeah. I mean, who doesn't hate Mr. Potter? Like, he's trying to put George Bailey down, this old man Potter. And then, you know, so you don't like him. But then there's also bad guys like, for example, you know, Hannibal the Cannibal Lecter from Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
Disturbingly evil. Dark, evil, smart, clever, like messes with your mind, psychologically evil, but also like just like scary, but yet you don't really see it. You just kind of feel like this evil presence. And then you have like another one I'll bring up is because it's kind of like that, that like all American, like when you're patriotic, like Ivan Drago from Rocky IV, when he's fighting Rocky, you know, for America, it's Russia versus America. Yeah. And we're going to, you know, and that's like, it gets you like all your red, white, and blue, patriotic, pumped up. We're going to, so you have like that kind of bad guy too, right? So that's the fun thing about the bad guy, the villain or the villainess, whoever you want to say. There's just these great different levels and different dynamics of the movies that bring these villains to life that makes them so much fun to hate and to love in some cases.
Yeah, I think it's, again, I think because our society, you have to be good. You got to play by the rules. So when you see someone that just like anyone beating the system, just saying like the hell with the rules and being a bad guy, I think what was it in the movie Spaceballs when Moranis, whatever the actor, he's playing a Darth Vader. He goes like, good is dumb. Good is boring, you know? And I think there's something really true in that is that, like...
So Dark more. Helmet. That was his name. Dark Helmet. Remember so the giant helmet?
Yeah.
I can't forget the actor's name. It's going to kill me.
Rick Moranis.
Rick Moranis. Yeah. The giant helmet. He had Give that goofy voice.
Remember that? Give me helmet. Well, I think that was
the best.
Yeah. It's just, I think everyone, at least for me, right? Speaking for us, because I always played by the rules and I was a straight A student. And I would see the bad boy who would just smoke in the back, tell the teacher to fuck off and like, you know, ditch class now, you know. And I always, I really, deep down inside, I idolized that dude. I'm like, yeah, man. And obviously the girls that were just went crazy over this dude, right? With the tats and no regrets and all this. Like,
right.
And then there I am, the good student, you know, and no, the girls didn't want any part of that, dude. It's boring.
Yeah. There's that bad boy image, right? People go back to that. Like,
the villain, exactly. The villain is, it's exactly what, because it does, just like being a really good guy, you know, even like a James Bond is good, but he's kind of a badass, right? He's not like a boring good guy, but I think it's that, just that expression of, and as I mentioned, yeah, the best villains tend to have those characteristics of intelligence being a formidable opponent, and also have some kind of cool look. But so, you know, for next Halloween coming up in a couple months here, you know, I think it's only appropriate we go as our favorite villain. So
I think it'd be a good idea. I'll have to think about that. There's some good ones.
I'll have to cut my hair. Definitely, I got to slick, slick it back.
Get some gel and get your suspenders. It's so funny. There's I was watching, I don't know if anybody listening watches The Office, the U.S. version. And there's this great Halloween episode where Ryan comes in and Kelly, his girlfriend, asks him, Oh, so what are you supposed to be? He goes, oh, I'm Gordon Gekko. And she said, oh, you mean from the insurance ad? He's like,
totally
sure. But he had the suspenders, a slick back hair. I'm like, oh, that is it's a good costume.
With a suit, maybe at my age I could do more Lex Luthor, Superman. We'll see what we do.
You have way more hair than Lex Luthor, though. That's the problem.
Or get
way more hair.
Get a perm and be like an evil Bob Ross, you know, some type of alter evil ego.
Bob Ross. But anyways, that would be a good one.
Well, listen, right John, on. Hey man, have a great Saturday night. Everyone out there, thank you so much again. Hey, and just to tell you, we really appreciate all your support and subscribing. We have our YouTube channel and we keep that fairly up to date. I got to tell you, I'm pretty diligent about that. And tell your friends. That's how we grow. So again, thank you, John. Have a beautiful evening, buddy.
Yep. Stay cool. Happy Labor Day. Happy Labor Day, everybody.
Happy Labor Day.
We'll see you guys. Take some time off from laboring.
Yeah. We'll see everyone next week.
All right.
See ya.
See you, buddy.